Yeah, 1205. He sent me a message. I wanted to introduce you to Mary Lynn, too. This is Nora. I got her with her mouth full. Nora works at the Area Agency on Aging, and Mary Lynn is the woman I told you about that has worked in nurse long-term care for years and years and retired to Holland. And but mostly it's all friends so far. So one person I haven't met. Oh, good to meet you, Sally. What?
You've met us, haven't you?
I think so. We give them their 5 minutes to come, so it's less disruptive that way.
Yeah, that work better.
Sure.
Because it's nice for them to get through the introduction.
Yeah. Right. What is a HERS story? Yes, I like it. I'm sorry I haven't made any of the others, because now I feel like I'm inventing it myself, but I know.
Yeah.
Yeah. Then I probably would think that I should do whatever they did. Right, right. Good. Maybe you can make me one that I could send my mother or someone. Yeah, that would be fun, because I'll probably say things here that my mother has never heard me say or whatever, you know. It's like when I had my 40th high school reunion, they sent us this thing and said, tell us your story and tell it in like one page that we can put in our newsletter. And I started, and by the time I was 15, I think I had 5 pages. So I said, forget it. You will find out. That's part of the story.
Okay, I'm on the edge of my seat.
You will find out. That's the first thing I talk about. This is where I grew up. Oregon.
Okay.
That part I'll tell you. It's not Oregon, it's Oregon. Yeah. Oh. Give them a couple more minutes.
Yeah.
You better get here.
He was really excited to be able to come. So.
Well, he and I just had a really long conversation few days ago, because he did his sabbatical leave last year, and I get copies of all the sabbatical leave reports, but I rarely read them, and his caught my eye, and it was about diversity, and, well, you've added some balance to the room, Paul. I don't know her. Yeah. That was a step up.
Yeah.
Wow.
Well, a story like that tells you that with something inside, you can. Being a perfect. Right.
Yeah, that's cool. That's a big job.
Yeah.
They should be here shortly, we'll hope.
We're waiting for a pass that should be arriving. As soon as I get here, it gets
good. So back to talking. This Aaron, for the introduction, do you need this first? Here they come, I betcha. Yeah. Changes the texture. Mm-hmm. Changes the texture. Yeah. All right.
Can't wait to talk.
You'll be fine.
Which is bad because I'm going to be mistress of ceremonies at a wedding reception tomorrow.
Okay, get yourself geared up.
This is my good practice.
Right. Yeah, there you go. So why don't we go ahead now? Yeah. There's some up here, always in the front, you know. I don't see him yet, anyway. You're from David Baer's class. Is he coming? Okay. Okay. Good. All right. I think it'll be fine, yeah.
Good afternoon, everybody. Oh, there's your professor. There's a seat up here.
There are several kind of students.
Two over there. Standing room. There's another seat right over there.
Claudia?
Oh, okay.
Okay. Let's go ahead.
Okay. Thank you, everybody, for coming. Welcome to Her Story. My name is Erin McGrain. I'm a volunteer with the Women's Center here at Grand Valley. The GVSU Women's Center opened in August of 2001, and the mission is to create a GVSU community that promotes and supports present and future success of women. It's a physical place and a resource, and it's open to all members of the campus and larger community. The Women's Center collaborates with on and off campus entities to provide quality services and programs that support enhanced education on gender issues. All information about the events in the Women's Center can be found on the website, and that's on the printed materials that I left on some of the tables if you want to check those out. We always welcome the opportunity to collaborate with individuals, offices, and organizations. And this afternoon, we're pleased to introduce Priscilla Kuboko, Dean of Graduate Studies and Grants Administration. And if you guys have any questions during the presentation, you can wait until she's done speaking. So, if you guys will join me in welcoming Priscilla.
I I always like to have copies of things, so I have copies of what I'm saying and some pictures of my family up here, which can be available if people want them. But I wanted to just thank the Women's Center for asking me to do this. It was a good exercise, actually, in starting to look back. And I'm at that point in my life where I should be looking back, you know, and remembering all the great things that happened. And the more I thought about this, the more things I remembered. So it was a good experience. I want to just tell you a little bit about my background, because as you heard, I'm a dean of graduate studies and grants administration, but I certainly didn't start out that way. I came from Oregon. I'm a native Oregonian, fourth generation. That means on my father's side, my great-grandfather was a toll gatekeeper on the Barlow Pass Road, which was the first road that ever was built over the Cascades. So, you know, they've been there a while. They were pioneers on my father's side. And my mom and dad were still pioneers, even though, you know, in the 40s you wouldn't expect that they would be pioneering, but they decided to go out and live in the woods. They bought a quarter section of timber land and built a little house out in the middle of the woods, and that's where I was born and grew up till I was 6 or 7. We were really at least a mile away from any other road that was of any nature, and the road we drove on had little streams in the middle of it. It was pretty rough, but it was a beautiful place to live, and I remember it with great fond memories of living deep in the woods and picking blackberries and playing in the maples and doing all kinds of great things. And then sad thing happened. My grandfather had come to live with us and worked with my dad, who was a logger. He was logging the land, the trees, and had his little sawmill, and then he would take the lumber down to the bigger mills and sell it. That was the way he made money. And in an accident, logging accident, my grandfather was killed, so my dad didn't want to log anymore. And we picked up and moved to another place, and it was on the other side of the mountains. Now, on the west side of the mountains where I grew up, the forest is deep, and on the other side of the mountains, it's high desert. So I grew up from about the age of 7 on in the high desert of Oregon in little towns, Prineville and Bend. So, you know, I started out in a house with no running water, no electricity, and we made progress. We got into a 3-bedroom house, but there were 7 of us. I'm the second child of 7, second daughter, and we were pretty crowded in that 3-bedroom house. So we spent most of our time playing outside or reading or doing other things that were quiet so you didn't disturb my mother, who was trying to run this home. As I said, I'm the second of 7. I'll have an older sister, 4 girls, 3 boys, the girls one. There's only a 12-year span between my older sister and my younger sister. So you know, at the time I didn't realize, but my mother's a saint. And quite amazing. And my dad also was the sole wage earner, because my mom was busy keeping us, fed and clothed and so on at home. He tried a lot of different things. He was a logger, as I said, and then when we moved to this small town on the east side of the mountains, in Prineville, he worked in a sawmill until the union went on strike, and he couldn't feed us with the union wage, you know, wages. So he just quit that kind of a job and took a job as a salesman. And he's pretty good at selling things. He sold everything you can imagine, but he started out selling tires, and he got really good at that and became the manager of this particular line of tires. The man's name is Les Schwab. You probably wouldn't know it unless you've been on the West Coast, and there's Les Schwab tire stores everywhere. But it started in Prineville, and my dad was the first one to start a second one. We all moved in about 40 miles away to another town called Bend, which is at the time I was there was about 10,000. Now it's about 80,000. So it's a town that's grown dramatically because it's a beautiful part of Oregon. And in his spare time, when he wasn't working 7 days a week, my dad was a pastor, a lay pastor. He didn't have any training to be a pastor, but he was a pastor in the conservative Baptist tradition, and so he held services in a small town that was about 20 miles away from where we lived. So every Sunday we got in the car and drove, 9 of us in the car, we didn't have any seat belts or anything like that, but you know, you couldn't move, so it was pretty safe. And obviously I survived that. This is a pretty strict denomination, and be familiar to some of you in this area. I think it's very similar to what I observe here. where there were no cards, no dancing, no makeup, no TV, lots of things you didn't do. But we still had a great time playing and working and so on. I would say we were a working class family, but comfortable because my dad always worked. There was always food on the table. We had a lot of hand-me-downs, but hey, didn't hurt. I was very active in the church and sang in the choir. I was a pretty good soloist, and I sang in a trio, and I loved that music. And I was president in my high school years. I was president of the statewide Girls Association, kind of like Blue Birds or Girl Scouts, but it was for the church called King's Daughters. As a person, I always loved school. I loved reading. I loved trying new crafts, you know, trying new things. I loved to climb trees and climb everything that was in sight. I played touch football. I ran. I was a bookworm. All of those things together, that was who I was. In high school, a girls' counselor advised me that I should take typing and home ec because obviously coming from the background I did, she didn't assume that I would be much more than a secretary or maybe, you know, a mother. And I'm fairly defiant. You'll discover that that's a pattern in my life. And so I wanted to prove to her that I was more than that. And I got straight A's and became the valedictorian of my high school class. And my best friend, who was really smarter than me, but a little less driven to prove herself, came in second with like, you know, a quarter of a point of a grade or something less. But we were good friends. I graduated then in 1962, so you can guess that's quite a while ago, from Bend Senior High School, and there were 200 students in my class. And so then the next thing to do was to figure out what do I do next, and I really wanted to go to college. My older sister had gone to a two-year college that was run by the church. But that wasn't my ambition. I wanted to go to a university, so I applied all over the place and I got scholarships and so on, but my family couldn't afford the costs that weren't covered by the scholarships, so I ended up going, not to a bad place, to the University of Oregon, which was the major state university in Oregon, and to the Honors College on a full tuition scholarship, and I just laugh now because the full tuition scholarship was $300 a year. But there were other expenses, you know. You had to pay for your lodge, you know, your board and room, and my mom and dad could take me back and forth to school, so I didn't have transportation issues. But they didn't have money to. They still had five kids at home. There was no way they were going to pay. So I worked very hard to pay for my room and board. And this was the biggest challenge of all I've ever had, I think, because I'm not an early morning person. I never had been. You know, my mom would sing songs to me to wake me up in the morning, and it was very tough, and I didn't like waking up. And so I would put my head back under the covers and be the last one to catch the bus. We had to take a bus to school. I had to get up before everyone else in my house where I lived in order to fill the furnace with sawdust. Now, remember, we're in Oregon. It's timber country. They had furnaces that were sawdust based, and so I had to get up in the morning and stoke the furnace with the sawdust, and that was the way I paid for my board and room. Really tough. I forgot to mention that in my senior year in high school, we didn't travel a lot with nine people. You might guess that. But I really wanted to be like an AFS exchange student, and my family couldn't afford it, so we said, well, instead we'd bring someone, we'd host a family, and we were actually accepted, and in my high school year, we were the host for an AFS exchange student from Indonesia, and a Muslim boy named Mariono Aliputra. Now, normally they would have, because I was the senior, they would have had a girl, but because I had a brother just a year younger than me, they figured this would work out, and it did. But it was quite an experience for my family to host a Muslim. Remember, my father's a lay pastor, and he's really into saving souls. And Mariano was the most dedicated, devoted Muslim there was. He prayed as he was supposed to every day, and he ate certain foods and didn't eat others. And so we all learned a lot about Indonesian cuisine and had an interesting year. That's just the first part of my story. College was an interesting thing. I had been quite successful in my high school, as I told you, And I was a leader, and I did a lot of other things in the high school. I, you know, was known as the leader, and that was great, but it was small, remember? 200 students in my class. University of Oregon was a different story. And I was like a small fish in a big pond. And I was the first time ever to be in a place where there were people who were a lot smarter than me all around me. And I felt very intimidated that first year. I was in the Honors College with kids who came from Portland, which is the big city, you know, so you know, they had honors classes and they had had advanced placement this and that, and I really was pretty intimidated that first year. But I was determined again that I was going to be, I was planning to be a missionary doctor or a linguist. Those were the two things that really fascinated me, translation work and medicine. So I started out on a pre-med program, and there's more to that story than I want to say, but I met my husband in my first year because he was in a chemistry class I was taking. I wasn't teaching. I was taking a chemistry class at 8 o'clock in the morning. Don't forget how hard it was for me to wake up. But chemistry at 8 o'clock in the morning was not easy for me, but the professor had decided to go away from a textbook, and we were going to read Scientific American reprints. And it was at the time the first discussions of DNA and the helix and all of that. And this poor foreign student who had studied English for 6 months and then got sent to school in Oregon to do a college degree, speaking another language, French, quite well, but English was new to him. He needed help, and somehow he looked around that room of 300 students and decided I was the one who would help him, even though I was mostly falling asleep in chemistry class. So. That was how we met, because I agreed, being the great helper that I think is part of my second child role, to help him. So I learned probably more in chemistry for that period of time than I did for the rest of the class, because I was trying to have to explain everything to someone who didn't read English as well as I did. And I also had, because I couldn't travel, because we never traveled, I was really fascinated with foreign students, and I had in my house that I lived in, it was called Ann Judson House. I don't know if any of you know this, but Ann Judson was a missionary to China. And so this house, as you can see, was run by the church and was for girls to keep us safe. Had hours that you had to be in, girls, certain hour of the night, every night. Got a little bit later on the weekend, but it was no later than 11 ever. And the door locked, and every man was out. But anyway, Ann Judson House was a fun place to live, and a lot of foreign students would like to live there because it was a smaller place than a dormitory and a safer place in some ways. So I had roommates that were from Thailand and India and Hong Kong and the Philippines. I really had fun having foreign students as roommates. Well, as I was kind of pointing out, chemistry and I didn't do too well together. So I looked around at my interests and decided I would switch over to anthropology because of the linguistics component of anthropology. You know, you've got four fields, you study physical anthropology, you study cultural anthropology, you study linguistics, and archaeology. So those are the four parts of anthropology, and I was interested in linguistics and I started down that path. But in this meantime, my husband became my boyfriend. He wasn't my husband yet. And my friend, he kept asking me out and painting pictures and sending them to me and do all kinds of things that to attract me and asking me really foolish questions like, what do American boys do when they like a girl? And, you know, and I was foolish enough to tell him some of these things, being the great, you know, I had just had a foreign student in my home for a year, so I kind of was playing the same role of trying to orient him to American culture. Really, he had another agenda, but at the time it didn't occur to me for a while. But eventually we really did care about each other. But his program was such that he got, he was here under the U.S. government sponsorship. I don't know if you know anything about the history of the Congo. I won't go into that a lot. But when the Congo became independent in 1960, there was no one who had more than a high school education. And they had no one prepared to be leaders. And so at that point, they sent people all over the world, to Russia and France and Switzerland and Belgium and US, to train them and get them educated so they could actually become leaders and run their country, with some limited success if you look at what's happened over the last 40 years. But at the time, he was there to learn to get a degree, and then the government said he had to go home. Well, he told them that he was very interested in pursuing a master's degree, and they said, no way, you're going to go home. And I said, well, you're not going to go home without me. And so we ended up talking to my parents, and we got married very quickly, and we went to Africa. So within, I was still a junior in college. I had done well in my program. I was along with some advanced placement and stuff. I was well past my junior year, but I hadn't got the degree. So it was an adventure. Remember, I'd never traveled anywhere, but I figured I could do anything, right? So that was kind of the way I was. I was going to try, and I was sure that love would cure everything. And it does make a difference. But it was a tough time. We ended up leaving the U.S. in March of 65, and you remember, you know kind of what the weather's like here. It was kind of like that when we left, so I was wearing black clothes and wool suits and clothing like that. Ended up in the Congo at 6:30 in the morning, and the temperature's already 85, and that was just the beginning. Where we were in the Congo at the time was called Leopoldville. It's now called Kinshasa. It's the main capital. It's the capital of the country, and it was just an incredible, challenging experience for me to adapt from being from Oregon in the cool, wet weather to the Congo in the tropical weather and all the other things that were going on. And to compound all of that, I got pregnant, you know? Didn't have things that we have today that would... Some we had, but we weren't really into that. So, So I got pregnant right away and spent my first year in the Congo pregnant. And my daughter, my first daughter was born in Congo. That country changed its name, by the way, to Zaire. For 30-some years, I've called it Zaire, and now I'm back to calling it Congo because they changed it back just recently. She was born in November of 1965, 2 weeks after Mobutu took over the country in a coup d'etat. So we were there during that period. There was a lot of turbulence. It was so different than anything I'd ever experienced. We didn't have a car for a long time. We took taxis and drove road buses, and then we hated the bus because it was too crowded, so we bought mobilettes. I mean, we really had to adapt. And it was interesting. I had a great book. It was written by Guttmacher, who's the founder of Planned Parenthood. And really why I bought it was because I didn't know if I would know what to do if I got pregnant. But, you know, it told you all the things that if you got pregnant, what the doctor would do and how he would, you know, take tests and do this and do that. Well, the doctor we saw never did any of those things. I thought it was a quack. I mean, he didn't follow the book. But he was Swiss, and he didn't follow the same pattern. And he would pat me on the head and look at me and say, you're looking really good. And that was about all he ever did. And so anyway, it was an interesting experience. But luckily for me, having babies is too easy. I mean, it took me less than 3 hours. Nobody believed that the first child would be coming this fast. They went away to take a nap and then found out that they were too late. So luckily for me, having childbirth was not a problem. But that was kind of the personal side of my life. At the same time, we discovered that colonialism hadn't really left. My husband, remember, had a degree, and he had assured me that with this degree, he would go home and he would support me fully. And you know, the kind of ideal, he's the husband, I'm the wife, he supports me. We got back and he had his degree, and he was given a job that's quite an important job as what they called a school inspector. And I'll talk a little bit more about that. But he was getting the equivalent of $30 a month. We couldn't live or even pay for rent at the time for $30 a month. So it didn't take us very long to figure out that $30 a month wasn't going to cut it, and that I probably needed to work too. But remember, I don't have a degree. I have my high school diploma and 3 years of college, but no specific degree. But I went out and I became, guess what? I became a United Nations library consultant. And the reason for that is, I forgot to tell you, well, I'll tell you later, that I worked during my high school years and in my college years also, besides filling the furnace, I worked in a library as a page. And now a page is the person who takes all the books that people return and puts them back on the shelf, gets to see what everybody else is reading. I also typed catalog cards in the days when you had to type catalog cards. So that was what I did as a student. And so I had some familiarity with what they call the Dewey Decimal System. And, I was going to be the consultant to the National Library of the Congo. And the reason for that was that they had been given hundreds of books by the America, by Britain, by Australia. All these countries were sending books to their national library in English. And nobody there knew English, had any idea what to do with these books except leave them in big piles. And they wanted to catalog them and put them in a place where people could access them. Now, they didn't have a library where you walk around through the room. They had a library where everything's in a big room, just numbered. But then they had catalog cards that told you what books were on what topics. And then you told somebody which book you want. It's kind of like our guy out here. Somebody goes and pulls that book off the shelf and brings it to you. But if you don't know what it's in the book, you can't catalog it. So my job for my first 7 months or so before Rochelle was born was to catalog English books. Now, remember? Well, maybe you don't remember. I haven't gotten there yet. I didn't speak French. I had 1 year of college French. They didn't speak English. I'm working in a place where where we don't have a common language. I'm just going to skip back to kind of the outline of my life and then come back to my career part in just a few minutes. So we lived in the Congo for what I would consider a very long time, 3.5 years. About as long as it takes you to finish a degree. But it was a life-changing experience in many ways. And then we said, well, we'll go back. I was guaranteed by my husband that I'd get to finish my degree. He wanted to get a master's degree. We got permission from the government, from his job. We came back, and we stayed here the rest of our lives. And there's a long story to that which I won't go into, except that it would have been a very bad thing for him to go back. And I could talk about that. That wasn't kind of in my career, but it did in fact impact our lives. But we didn't know that for about 6 years. So for the first 6 years we came back, our whole life was kind of oriented around when we go back to the Congo, when we go back to the Congo. And a lot of the choices we made were about that. And we waited a long time to have another child. I mean, my first daughter was so busy. I didn't think I could possibly handle two. And so we delayed it. There were reasons, no insurance, this, that, and so on. But we delayed it quite a while. But then my daughter, Nicole, was born in September of 1972. She goes by Nikki, not Nicole. Rochelle goes by Rochelle, but Nicole is Nikki. So anyway, she was born, and we have two daughters. About the same time, I had returned to college, and I had finished my bachelor's degree in anthropology with great excitement. I love that field, but I couldn't figure out what I would do with it exactly. Because linguistics was interesting, but I was moving away from that interest. So I went on and studied some more anthropology. What the heck, you know? I studied for a master's degree in anthropology. I passed all the courses. I passed the comprehensive exams. It was time to write a thesis. I said, well, I think I'll get a doctoral degree instead. So I did switch from anthropology because, again, I was really struggling with how do you do anthropology with a family. I couldn't quite connect how I would do anthropology with a family. Archaeologists, you know, out digging. It just didn't seem like the right place to have my kids, out digging or in some foreign culture other than the one where I'd already lived. So I did go into a doctoral program that's called Urban Studies, Interdisciplinary Program. But it was really a self-designed program. I got to really work with a professor and choose the courses I wanted and kind of carve out my own path. And out of that, I studied policy and families. I was really interested in urban issues regarding policy and families, so that was what I was really focusing on at the time. It took me a long time to finish that one too. Having a family gets kind of in the way of, I could do the coursework, but the part where you had to do the independent research and, you know, do that dissertation, it just kind of gets shoved off a lot. But I actually was very lucky to have good faculty support, and I'll talk a little bit more about how that all happened. I eventually got the degree. There were three doctoral degrees, by the way, at Portland State. Portland State is in Portland, which is the largest city in Oregon, but the two universities, the major ones, are in Eugene, which is 120 miles south, and Corvallis, which is like another, kind of off to the side a little bit, 120. So I wasn't into commuting to either of those places, and Portland State was prohibited from offering any degrees that were already offered at those universities by the state of Oregon. So they were offering three degree options. One was environmental studies, primarily science. The other was systems science, which was just the beginning of a lot of stuff on computers. And the third was urban studies. I mean, the choice was pretty simple. That was the only one I was prepared to pursue. Just a little bit more about background, and then I'll talk more about career, because I think that's kind of what we want to talk about. I did finish my dissertation and defend it in July of 1982. That was 10 years after I started it. I was 38, so I was a late bloomer, as you say, as an academic. But I didn't participate in graduation. I never have walked in any graduation. It's kind of sad in a way. Because my husband had taken a job in Colorado. And so we were on our way to Colorado. And he was going to teach. He taught at the University of Colorado, Denver. And I was going to go and find a job because I didn't have one. So we were on our way with all of our belongings and possessions off to Colorado. And I did find a position in Colorado by kind of going about looking for things that were similar to what I'd done before, and I'll come back to that. Initially, I worked at the University of Denver Graduate School of Social Work. And I'll talk a little bit about that. Graduate School of Social Work was a very interesting environment. I did that for 2 years, and then I took a position. I was lucky to get a position, I think, as a faculty member on a tenure track, which I never really had as an ambition. In fact, I had vowed that I wasn't going to do it after I watched some of my faculty members struggle. I wasn't going to do that, but then I thought, well, yeah, I think I can do that. So my life has been kind of like that. I can do that. So I got a job at University of Northern Colorado, which is in Greeley. Greeley's 50-some miles north of Denver, and we lived in the suburbs, so it was 75 miles. I know because I counted every milepost. For 2 years, I drove back and forth every day to Greeley. And I taught in a program in gerontology. And you'll say, how did you go from this? That where's the connection, and I'll talk a little bit about that. But eventually I got tired of that drive. I don't know how people could do it every day for a long time. And we moved to Greeley, and this was a good move too because my daughter Nikki was struggling in a big school, and she ended up in the University Laboratory School, which was a great place for her. She bloomed there. Well, I did all the things you do to get tenure, and I'll talk a little bit more about that, which is a lot of work. And teaching, and I got tenure, and I got promoted to associate professor, and then I'm kind of going along, and it's pretty simple. I'm enjoying it, and I'm looking around saying, what else is there to do? This is kind of my nature. And I was really intrigued when there was an opportunity to serve for a one-year term as an assistant dean in the graduate school. I said, well, you know, universities don't pay very much attention to graduate school. This makes me pretty frustrated. I want to go figure out what we can do. Why we don't? What's going on? Why is this university, you know, offering these graduate degrees, but it never really talks about them? You know, this will be a familiar story for anybody who's been around me. I still talk like that here. But it was curiosity, in a sense. What is this all about? What does a graduate office do? I'd never worked in one. It was really interesting to me. So I went and did that for 1 year, and then another year, and then another year. And I stayed for 10 years. And that was kind of an experience that came to an abrupt end when my boss left, and there was a whole search process and a new president, new provost, all kinds of changes, and it seemed like it was time for me to move on. So I was very fortunate because I decided to move on with some encouragement of my friends, by the way. And my husband had retired, and he was going to follow me wherever I decided to go, which was nice because that doesn't always work. And I was lucky, I think, to get the position here at Grand Valley, and I'll talk a little bit about that. You know, in all of this, I'm going to kind of run through my education. You've heard a little bits and pieces of it. And work. What's the meaning of work in my life? Well, you know, work was really a part of what you had to do to be a part of a family of 9 people. So whatever it was my mother needed help with, that's what I did, as long as I could do it quickly so I could get back and read my book or do whatever else I wanted to do. Gardening, she had a huge garden, and that was important for us. She did a lot of canning, I helped with that. Housework, of course. Ironing, oh my goodness. You don't know how lucky you are that you don't really have to iron your clothes. We used to put big bags of clothes in, you know, 9 people. All the clothes go in this big bag, and they're spray starched, and then you have to get them out and iron real quick, or they get moldy, and oh dear, it was dust, not the dishes. We had a little place in Bend, which was where I graduated from high school, 5 acres. We called it the estate, you know, because we lived in the woods, and then we lived in a little town in a 3-bedroom house, and then we had this 5-bedroom house in Bend with 5 acres, and my mom and dad raised alfalfa, which is, you know, for hay, and on the other side of the fence, on the other side of the road, we had a place where we could raise calves. So the calves would be our friends until my dad was ready to, you know, butcher them, and then. But that was the way we survived, really. They were very, very careful. And we also raised turkeys. I could tell you that story. They really are stupid. I will tell you that much. My brother was into 4-H, and that was going to be, nobody else would have turkeys, so he was going to raise turkeys so he could win the prize at the fair, which he did. And then they gave him 100 turkeys. So anyway, long story. We won't go there. But I would just say, I even worked in the summers as a farm worker, you know? My grandfather lived in the other side of the mountains, back in the valley in Oregon, which is a farm country. And we would go over in the summer, my sister and I, and we'd live with him for a month or two, 6 weeks. And we would get up really early in the morning, like 4, and catch this bus, took us out to the fields, and we picked beans until it was too hot, and then we hid in the shade, and we got paid by the pound. Well, you know, and you're sticking your hands in, the beans are wet, and there's slimy ones and all of that. We had a great time, though. We worked hard, and that money was my money to spend any way I wanted, so it was worth it. You know, in a family of 9, you don't really often have money to spend for yourself. And it was great staying with my grandpa, because he spoiled us, and it was fun. I also babysat for everybody. I think I read every story that there ever is to read to every child, until I had my own, and then I was so tired of having read them to everybody else that I probably didn't do as good a job as I could have, but I did housework. I tried waitressing one time, lasted 2 weeks, and quit. That wasn't me. But then I ended up, as I said, at the library, which was great fun, because I love books, and I still do to this day. My house looks like the library, only it's not quite as well organized. And I loved, you know, there was one place where I couldn't get into the books. They had a little lock on it. I always wanted to know what the books were that were under lock and key. And I never did, but I was always curious. My senior year, because I had this interest in doing medicine, I thought it would be interesting. And I had a woman who was older than me, but not as old as my mother, you know, somewhere in that range, who ran a doctor's office. And so she invited me to work in the doctor's office for a while. And I, you know, I was doing clerical work, basically. I wasn't doing anything medical. But I got to talk with that physician, who was a very unhappy man. He was an internist. He was single. He didn't have anything else in his life but his career. And he was not happy because people didn't, you know, he said things like, you can't do this if you expect people to be faithful. And he was sad. It was sad in a sense, because he wasn't happy, and he was helping a lot of people who were ill. Those were the people he spent his day with. But I still figured I could be a doctor and help people. During college again, I did the same kinds of things, worked in the library, babysat. I had a brief job, it was before work study, you know, but they were always looking out for things for me to do, and I ended up in the state of higher education in Oregon has a system, and so I worked in the state office, the office of the higher education system, and they gave out scholarships, so I was in the office, you know, reviewing all these files of all these other people who were going to be getting scholarships. So I had a little bit of a career there working in an office. And I also, during the summers, was really lucky, I thought. I got a job in Portland. My sister lived in the suburbs in Portland, and I went to live with her and carpooled. My uncle got me this job. He talked to people, and they said, yes, they would try me out. And my job was as a clerk in the mailroom. And that was a really interesting job. You had to know how to count. You had to keep records. I kept an inventory. I mailed out big packages. I learned how to use a stamp machine. There were a lot of things I did. But all of this was so I could earn money to go back to college. And then there was my experiences in the Congo. I worked in the Congo initially as a United Nations consultant for the library, and I did take the Dewey, they had a system called the Universal Decimal System. It wasn't the Dewey Decimal System. And I would take the book with all the instructions, I would look at the book that they had sent, and I would make a decision how to catalog that book. And I did that for several months. And then I went on maternity leave and came back briefly. But in the meantime, my husband had gone around, he was working for the Department of Higher, Congolese Higher Education Department. And he told them they were desperate for English teachers. He told them, I could teach English. I said, what do you mean I can teach English? He said, well, you speak English. Yeah. He had been trained as a teacher. So he convinced them that I could teach English. And I ended up, remember, I'm a Baptist, conservative Baptist. I don't know what that means to you. But I ended up teaching my first year in the Lycée du Sacré-Cœur, which was a Catholic girls' school. With nuns who wore everything, the only thing you could see was their face and their hands. And they were everywhere. And then I also, that was quite an experience, just the culture shock of being in a Catholic school. One of my stories I tell, and I should talk a little faster because I'm taking up all the time, no time for questions, was when the Archbishop came to school and everyone had to go and kiss the ring of the Archbishop. And I just didn't know what to do, you know. This was not my tradition at all. But I found a way of kind of like curtsying and moving on, and that was quite an experience, but the whole experience was challenging. I was teaching seventh grade girls. Now, I don't know how many of you remember what it's like to be 11 or 12. 40, bigger group than this, maybe about the same size as this. I didn't speak any English, or French. They didn't speak any English. I'm supposed to get up in front of them and teach them English. And they just let me loose to do that. And Andre, of course, every night would work with me on my lesson plan. And I swear, I dreamed in lesson plans all night long because I'd never had any preparation. And actually, you know, after a while, I did begin to learn French. I mean, actually, I did learn French. But in the meantime, I'm up in front of a class trying to talk to them, not knowing anything to say in French that I could, you know, 1 year of college French doesn't really get you too far down the road. And they would laugh at me and I would laugh at them and we'd try to figure it out. But it was a hard class for me to run. 11, 12-year-old girls are pretty unruly and there were 40 of them in the class. About half of them were on this side were daughters of European folks. And on this side of the class you had the kids who were the daughters of the ministers and so on for the Congolese government or businessmen. It was like the class was split in half. They didn't talk to each other. I was supposed to make it into a class. And I didn't know how to speak the language. It was a challenge. And it was probably my one failure. And the only consolation is that they gave the class to another teacher who had many years teaching experience and knew French very well because she was from Belgium. And she couldn't manage it either, so they split it up. So that was my consolation. I also taught ninth grade girls. I taught English as a first or a second language, a third language, and a fourth language. So there were some girls that I saw only twice a week. And at the same time, they asked me, why don't I go over to this other school on the other side of the city where it's run by the Jesuits, and it's for men, and it's a school for architecture. Now, they're not in the architecture school. They're getting ready to get into architecture. I know nothing about architecture. Well, my dad had built houses. That was about how much I knew. But I had all these magazines about architecture in English, and we would use those as our textbooks, and that's how I taught architectural English. It was fun. It was scary. And I survived. I think a lot about that first, that year was a very challenging year. The next year I taught in another kind of school, was just for boys, was run by the Salvation Army, called the Institute of the Salvation Army. And it was a secondary school for boys, all Africans. They lived I lived right across the street from the school, no adventures getting to work. Wasn't too hard to walk across the street. I knew the people. They were more like me. They had more of the Protestant faith background, and so that was interesting. But I was still trying to learn the language French and trying to learn some of the African languages, because my husband's family didn't speak French, his parents. So I was trying to learn Lingala, which is the trade language, and I was picking up, you know, as you learn a language, you can hear things before you can speak them. So the kids are in the class and they're talking about me, you know, in Lingala, because they think I can't understand. And every so often I could insert a comment here or there and say something, and they would just break up and great. They thought that was so funny, and they were kind of excited that I was interested in learning the language. And I'll say this about, you probably wouldn't believe it, that some of the nuns had lived in the Congo for 30 years and they didn't know a single word of the African language. And I kind of asked one of them about that one time, and they said, we are here to civilize the Africans. So learning French was civilizing them. But I was wanting to learn their language, and that was something that was important to them. I won't go on too much more about that period, and I'll just talk a little bit more to kind of get you a sense of what happened when I came home. When I came home, I stayed with my daughter. We came back in 68. I stayed with my daughter 1 year. I'm not the great mother who loves to stay home with her children, I discovered, because she was so busy, and I had no adult conversation, and so I decided I would take a class by correspondence in architectural drafting, and I got pretty good at that, and I was doing, well, you know, after all, I've been teaching architecture English, so I took architectural drafting, and I decided I would go back to school. Andre agreed, and he was going to school, by the way. He was working a graveyard shift and another shift and doing this during the day, and we were really serious on getting our education and getting back to the Congo. So I got enrolled in school, and as I said, but at the same time, we couldn't kind of live just on his income, even though he was doing as much as he could. So I got a job, but it wasn't in architectural drafting. They wouldn't hire a woman, and I discovered that. So I ended up with a job in a field that I had absolutely no preparation for. Cost accounting clerk. Lumber company, wholesale, I was a cost accounting clerk. I did all this analysis of the loads that they were shipping out all over the country. That was my job. I did a little cost accounting stuff. I got pretty good at it. So I said, well, I want to try being a salesman. Oh, we couldn't consider that. We tried a woman once and that didn't work. So I decided that wasn't a place to stay. I found another part-time job in a small manufacturing firm, and I worked with the controller and the bookkeepers and did cost accounting for a while on the side while I was going to school. And I also had a graduate assistantship eventually. The graduate assistantship means that I have to work 10 or 12 hours at the university, this half-time job over here, and I had two children that I was trying to, you know, keep going. And so at some point, I decided that I really needed help. And I went to my major advisor. This is by the time I'm in my doctoral program, and she worked out a deal for me to have a full-time assistantship, meaning that I could work 20 hours a week at the university, right where I was taking classes and kind of consolidate my efforts. And that was great. And I ended up then working with various professors. I worked on the beginning of a criminal justice program. It was at the time, it was a new idea to have a degree in criminal justice. And we were one of the first universities in the country to develop one. And I did a lot of research, what kind of things professors taught that might be relevant. I did all that kind of work. So I basically ran out of money as an assistant because they only gave you 3 years. I finished all my coursework. I passed my comps with honors, but it was time to write a dissertation, and I couldn't. I had a topic that ended up that I couldn't actually get the result. The professor whom I was going to work with decided he didn't want me to do my piece. So then I had to start over. Sidetracked. I went to work for the county. Urban studies is very closely related to urban planning. I ended up working for Multnomah County in Oregon for about 3 years as an urban planner assistant. I was assisting with everything. Land use planning, if any of you have studied that, is a field that's Oregon's very well known for, because they created something called the urban growth boundary, and you couldn't put housing in the rural agricultural area. You had to keep it in the urban areas. And I was right there working on that at the very beginning. From that, I could never get my dissertation going, and I still wanted to finish. You know, you hate being kind of a half-done person, half-baked. Get all that work, didn't get credit for it in a sense because I didn't have the degree. So I was lucky to work with my major professor again, and she and another student and I sat down and wrote a grant proposal to do a project that was going to be an interesting study, and I forgot to bring the book today. But out of that project, which lasted for 2.5 years, we wrote a book called Helping Networks and Human Services. It was a national study where I went to about 10 different places around the country, first time I'd ever traveled by myself, and did case studies of programs that were working with professionals, working with what they called informal helpers. And it was a very interesting project, and it was one that kept me from doing my dissertation again. But again, I was working closely with my major professor, and finally was able to pull together a piece of that project to do as my dissertation, which I finished, as I told you, just as my husband and was taking a job in Colorado. So it all worked out, kind of, but it was not easy. In Colorado, I worked at University of Denver, Graduate School of Social Work, did a lot of work there. I worked with the Institute on Aging, got very interested in the field of aging, which was part of what I had studied at Portland State, but I hadn't really focused on it before. But I couldn't be hired as a social work professor because I don't have any credentials as a social worker. And that one of the requirements is that you have a MSW, at least, in order to work as a social work professor. So I had to look elsewhere, and that's when I ended up in Northern Colorado. And I think I kind of told you how I went from teaching and getting promoted and so on, moving on to this graduate area. And I love graduate education. I had a job that never changed. I mean, that was always changing, learning new things all the time. And it's been a really good experience. I did admissions, I did financial aid, I did all of these things for graduate students, and with staff. And it was a good experience. Now, it makes it sound like I've done all this on my own, and I wanted just to point out, just coming to Grand Valley was the last step. I had interviews at about 5 universities, but something about Grand Valley intrigued me. And I guess what it was another opportunity to start something new, because there's never been a graduate dean at Grand Valley before, and there'd never been a grants office. And those are the two major assignments that I have. So in my life, I kind of keep finding myself in places where I have to pull it together and make something happen, and that's been great. How does this happen? You know, what is it about me that's made this possible? first of all, I think I should say very strongly that my parents were both people who, if they'd had the resources, would have been brilliant. They were both very, very intelligent. My mother wanted to be a teacher. My dad had been admitted to MIT, but didn't have the money to go. He loved everything about him. He was always learning new things. Being a pastor without any training, and very good at it. So I had good role models, and they always encouraged. And I have brothers and sisters who didn't reject me when I married someone of another race. At the same time as I was marrying my husband, I knew many other women who married across race and who were basically disowned by their families and never saw them again. So that was an important part of my success, to have that kind of support. I learned from my husband, too, because remember, I said he came here in 6 months. He studied at Georgetown for 6 months, and then they sent him to college. And he was supposed to get A's and B's and succeed in college, or he would get sent back home. So he did. He got A's and B's, and he studied very hard. It was hard work, but he succeeded. And he's been a kind of an inspiration in many ways. I've always had teachers and professors who believed in me, encouraged me. I don't think I ever had anybody who just said, you are the one person, we're going to work with you, you're going to succeed, I'm going to mentor you. I've never had anyone say that to me. And sometimes I feel sad and I say, why is that? Well, probably because I'm too off doing my own thing too fast before they have a chance to say that she can succeed or she can't. But there have been many, many people along the way who encourage me. And I learned from people I work with. You know, every job I've taken, I've had to have some new skills. And you learn it from the people around you. At DU, there was the professor in aging who was such a passionate advocate for older adults that you couldn't work with her and not become interested and excited about the field, Enid Cox. And even my experience as a professor in gerontology, which is what I taught, by the way, the person who was hired with me was a woman 15 years younger than me. Very, very good as a professor. Extremely good. You know, I was kind of learning still. I hadn't been kind of socialized to do all this, because then I basically said I didn't want to be a professor. So it was really good for me to work with her, because she had the whole track figured out, and I could work with her and learn. A good friend that, when I became an associate dean, who would tell me to my face when I was being unreasonable, which I'm often unreasonable. Some people in the room know that. It was Maria Lopez. And Maria was a person who initially we were like cats. You know, you don't get along because you're both very powerful, you know, and strong-willed people. And finally we got past that, and we are friends for life. And she'll tell me when I'm crazy. And I don't like it. And I tell her that, and she says, that's too bad. It's the truth. So that's a mentor. That's a person who really cares about me enough to tell me the truth. I actually learned from my boss as a graduate dean. He was not a person that we have a lot in common. He was Southern. He probably felt a little awkward working with me. I didn't have the graces of the people that he had grown up with. But he was very helpful in helping me learn to be a good leader. You know, I learned a lot from him about how to prepare a report and, you know, how to present it and so on. All through my life, I think I've encountered people who, from whom I could learn if I just paid attention. And I think I'm very lucky to have found the same kind of people at Grand Valley all around me. Two that I want to mention, one is John Gracke, who, when I came here, I was hired, I was told I would report to the provost, and at the time the provost was Glenn Niemeyer. And I arrived 4 months later and I was told I reported to the associate provost, not to the provost. You know, and you're thinking, well, what the heck is that? But it turns out that was the blessing, because John Gracke has been here forever and he loves to tell the stories, and he would tell me how things work at Grand Valley. You know, if you don't know how things work, you can make big mistakes, or if you walk right in thinking you got all the answers. So John was a good person for me to work with that first year. He cared enough to tell me when I, you know, needed to take another tack. And Gail Davis has been a great provost too. She's a role model, very calm, very clear where she's headed, good at giving me feedback. I've talked and talked too much. And I know some of you have to leave. It looks like students, maybe. If anybody else wants to stay around and ask questions, I'd be happy to answer.
Thank you, everybody.
And if you want one of these, you get more details than what I've said, you're welcome to those too.
Thank you guys for coming. If you could take a second and fill out the evaluation sheets on the tables, we'd really appreciate it.
And I didn't get to say this in front of everybody, but we have a small token of...
Oh, no. Those are pictures. Yeah. These are just pictures of things in my life that me. I wish I had more of the pictures. I don't have all of them in digital form.
One of my best experiences coming to Green Valley is meeting you. What a lovely.
Thank you. Too.
Oh, too much talking.
This is for you.
Thank you. I didn't really expect that. Okay. Thank you. See you soon. Bye. Yeah. Have whatever. I get carried away. Don't worry. As you see, I talk too much. You got both pieces. Okay. Thought it might be good to at least lay it out. I want to read all of this. If you, oh. I just ran
yes,
off
thank
some
you.
Stuff.
That's quite a story. You got from place to place to place.
Yeah, it's been fun thinking about it.
That's good. Doing it or thinking about it?
Well, some fun and some not.
Some not, yeah.
You some not.
Had a time with the two little girls.
And I have beautiful, I didn't even talk about my granddaughter, but I think they're in my pictures.
You like these? Ah, all right.
Hi. Thank you so much for tolerating my students. But
you
I'm so glad.
Okay?
Oh, yeah, I'm so glad they were able to come in and hear this. I mean, it's so ties into so many issues we talk on. So, issue of opportunity. What are the opportunities to learn and learn? So I think it was really nice to have a lot of discussion after this on class on Friday.
I've thought about it a lot, you know, because I was going to do this and I kept thinking, what is it about me? I mean, why did I keep
going? It's a story that ties in with all the broader themes that we keep talking about in terms of educational opportunity.
And
so
basically, I learned that you have to land on your feet, and the only way to do that is to put your head to, you know, really work hard, I guess, and
I have to see the pictures.
Oh, that's so cute.
I noticed all the people who were coming up, or all the staff to see the pictures.
Oh, that's so cool.
Nikki sent me some. Nikki's a photographer, you know, so she's rated all of our photos, and I said, you've got to send me back some.
I don't think I'd ever share my high school pictures with anyone.
I actually thought I looked pretty good.
Oh, I do too, I think.
When you
that's college. That was just the annual picture that they took of us. Funny, yeah, thank you.
Go on, I guess. And on and on.
Thank you very much.
Thanks again for coming.
Oh, yeah, and I'm Mary. Nice to meet you.
David Bear.
Thank you for coming. I really appreciate it.
I really enjoy these myself, and I have my students really good. It's an education class. A lot of these things have come up in our course.
There's another one in Allendale. I don't know how easy that would be for you.
I teach down here at the Upper Heart Center, but next year I'm teaching in Allendale.
Well. Well, thank you so much for coming.
I should probably stop.